But truly, what is a creative idea worth? What is it worth to expand our own definition of risk beyond the structured approach to minimizing liability and maybe begin to look at the risk associated with being too structured along the way? And you guys know that the way our mind is set up, the way it's designed, is we've got this analytical, logical, rational problem-solving space in our mind. We've also got this intuitive, risk-taking, emotional problem-solving space in our mind. Yet, particularly in the Western Hemisphere here as adults and professionals, we actually exist in this logical problem-solving space in our mind the vast majority of our adult waking life. And we're naturally resistant to venturing out into that uncharted, and indeed sometimes feel like it is vulnerable, risk-taking, problem-solving territory. But I also hold to the fact that it's not our fault. It's not our fault as adults or as leaders or even as parents, because for the most part, we were all taught and trained and disciplined to become logical. From the time that we all first entered school, we were taught to take all of these wonderful, different, cool, multidimensional type ideas and solutions, and then trained to narrow them down to come up with just one standardized response. One homogeneous solution that everyone else sitting in straight, well-behaved rows also came up with that just one singular response. And then that got a little worse as we became adults and we entered positions of leadership, because we were taught to become increasingly risk-averse, increasingly operationally efficient, and in a lot of ways just simply increasingly busy. So I've been increasingly vocal as I've been sharing this part of my message with the professionals that I've had the privilege to share with, because it's created a life of paradox where we talk about disruption, we talk about adapting to change, we talk about fluid thinking or expanded consciousness, but when it comes time to making a decision or writing a big check or meeting with an important client, we almost always revert right back to what has historical precedent, what has been proven by the big data or the analytics or the numbers. Now, certainly I want to pause for clarity here, because the development of that analytical, logical, numeric data problem-solving space of our mind, it is still absolutely necessary. In fact, it is still 100% categorically necessary, but I would also suggest no longer sufficient by which to engage in this increasingly competitive, rapidly changing global economic community. I think we need to come up with new and different ideas, maybe that your competitors never even thought possible, that your valued customers didn't even yet know that they needed, by breaking outside of business as usual. And so my presentation is very loosely titled The Art of Vision, or The Art of Mastery.
What is the purpose of art? Because I would suggest that the purpose of art is actually not to produce a finished product. Rather, the purpose of art is to produce thinking, dynamic thinking, game-changing thinking, the kind of thinking that wakes up our mind, shakes up our brain cells to be able to unlock intellectual curiosity. So I wanted to talk this morning about the future of automation, innovation, market regulation, asset allocation, risk mitigation, and economy's fluctuation, the escalation of inflation, interest rate manipulation, regional bank capitulation. Oh yeah, and how about the whole chatbox GPT situation? Maybe there's just still some lingering frustration with supply chain constipation or the great resignation, or this morning's USA team elimination. But it's not, I know, it's not lost on me that I know the only thing that now, or one of the few things now that stand between you and your favorite cocktail libation at the Bryan Adams celebration is me and this presentation. So I thought we'd start Quickly, and without any further ado, I want to open the channels to the fascination of our imagination. We wanted to open with something a little more interactive. You see, I've got a few more brushes and a couple more canvases. So I just wanted to see by a quick show of hands, who here can draw? Okay, well, I too am a numbers-based, evidence-based researcher, so I'd say just eyeballing it, it's probably a little less than half of you. Actually, don't feel bad. I ask that question of every audience that I speak to, and I will rarely even get even one brave soul that's going to raise their hand and say that they can, in fact, draw. But if I were going to go down to your high school, say any high school throughout the country, and I were to say the same thing, who can draw, I statistically will get between almost 8 to 10% of those students say they can, in fact, draw. But if I were to go down to your preschools, any preschool anywhere in the country, and I were to ask those kids, hey, kids, you know, who here can draw? What's the response that I'm going to get? Yeah. 100% of the time, these kids, even our own children, practically bursting at the seams, just dying to share with me their creative energy. At what age, then, do you think that creative river that once did flow so freely and effortlessly through each and every one of us. At what age do you think it started to dry up? Yeah. Young, early. Pablo Picasso said, you know, every child is an artist. The challenge is how to remain an artist once we grow up. John Lennon, prior to his untimely passing, was being interviewed by Rolling Stone magazine. They're asking him a little bit about his experiences with music. Where did it come from and what is the future? And he said something that I found fascinating. He said that music is comprised of basically 8 basic notes. However, the best music takes place between the notes. So I wanted to explore that a little bit further here with us is what is that space of opportunity, that space of excellence that takes place between the notes of traditional business wisdom? And again, wanted to make it a little more interactive here this morning. And, you know, did anyone here, by chance, bring their pack of Crayolas to the closing session? You guys remember these bad boys? That box of 64 with the sharpener in the back. Yes. So actually, when I'm brainstorming with various different individuals in sales and marketing or executives, and we're looking for new ways to grow channels of revenue, new ways to streamline operational efficiencies, or even attempt new things that have not been done before, I actually encourage the box of Crayola for taking all of those notes. Because when you were going in search of that which has not yet been invented, I'm not looking for the most operationally efficient form of a writing implement, but I'm looking to go out and search those bold, new, creative type ideas that historically I found Crayola's got that better chance to foster. Incidentally, a study at Yale University has shown that Crayola is one of the top 20 most recognizable smells in the adult human experience. I mean, that's up there with what? Dill pickles? Peanut butter coffee? It's even shown that just the smell of Crayola has been proven to reduce blood pressure in adults downwards 10 points. So if you've had any personal frustration with market regulation, you pull out your box of crayons and take a drag. See if that doesn't ease our frazzled connective nerves a little bit differently. But like I said, we want this to be a little bit more of an interactive type session. And I wanted to do a thought leader experiment. This is under the guise of exploring. And you guys, there's a television show. It was hosted by Joe Rogan. The title of the show is called Fear Factor, where they challenge these various different contestants to really do some outrageous different physical stunts or potentially eat some very interesting items, and sometimes often even do it in front of a live studio audience. So what I'm going to need here is a volunteer. Thank you, sir. Welcome to the presentation. I think I caught a few bounces off hands and shoulders before that made its way to the gentleman here. Who's got the ball for me now? You guys might have shoved. Oh, it's back there. Handed it off to another brave soul. Can I get your name real quick? Ann, where are you from, Ann? Irvine, California. Do me a favor and just go ahead and stand up. Introduce Ann from Irvine, California. So I've got in my hand a set of Fear Factor instructions that my new friend Angela from Orange County is actually going to go up onto stage to perform with all of you watching her. So, you know, come on up, Ann.
Sure, you don't want this?
Sorry.
You handed this to me, Mike. He set me up.
I get it. And I do want to kind of, as we are coming together more and more after a post-COVID environment, it's nice to be sharing the same breathing space and molecules together. I'm going to do something I don't normally do. And now, Ann, I'm going to allow you to be the leader of this experiment. And if you would like, you may now delegate or select any other person in the room that you would like to see go up on stage and to perform that set of instructions. So we all noticed the program's taking a little bit of an interesting dynamic turn here because smiles start to creep across your face. You've got the blood returning to your faculties, getting the swagger back. And if you also notice that those who just moments ago got enthusiastically rooting you onto the stage have all of a sudden quiet up. They're staring down at their shoelaces, trying not to make eye contact. For those of you in sales, that's kind of its own form of risk management. But Anna, what would you like to do?
So either I can do it.
Yes.
Or I'll delegate.
Or you delegate.
I'll do it.
Ladies and gentlemen. No better answer. Now, Anne, are you familiar with the show Fear Factor?
I sure am.
You are? And do you have any experience doing freestyle rap?
What was the question? What was the question?
Freestyle rap.
No.
No. Okay. What I'm going to have you do then, Anne, is I want you to take a deep breath.
Want your ball back?
I'll take the ball back. And I'll hold the mic for you if you like.
Okay.
Before you open that, I want you to take a deep breath, because I want this to be a moment that you and I never forget. And I say that with great intention, even great specificity, particularly in understanding general anxiety, in understanding performance pressure, and understanding that, and put yourself in Anne's shoes here for a moment, in understanding that relationship between performance and our mind, the breathing patterns that go along there, how we quiet our mind or it takes over us with anxiety. So that's why I like to take that special pause for taking that breath. But it's also intentionally kind of a dramatic pause. For those of you who haven't yet pulled out your smartphone recording device, you know that saying, what happens in San Diego goes up on TikTok. Yeah, go ahead and open that up and go ahead and read that aloud to our friends here. I'm going to step just slightly out of harm's way.
The painting of Lenin is yours to keep. Congratulations.
Yes, you can. That will be dry and waiting for you at the end of the show. So thank you. Sometimes it pays to take a risk. So
I was willing to rap.
I know you were. I saw it in your body language up here. But thank you very much. That'll be dry and waiting for you. And maybe just out of curiosity, you know, I'm in the business of art and where art takes form of value. You know, some art is worth so much. Really, most art isn't worth all that much. And I would just be curious. I've got $100 here that I would be willing to trade you. So I get the Lenin painting back and you keep the hundy.
Absolutely not.
You're going to keep the painting?
Yes, I'm going to keep the painting.
Then you earned it. That'll be waiting for you at the end of the presentation.
Thank you so
again,
much.
My pleasure. Thanks, Anne, for being my wingman. And I use this example all over the world with audiences, and less than 5% of the people who I give that option to delegate, or 5% keep it, 95% delegate, as most of us often do under pressure. So, Anne, you earned that painting. Congratulations.
Thank
that will be
so
waiting
much.
For you at the end. Yes. Sometimes it pays to take a risk. Now, I'm in the business of creating disruptive strategies. That's what I do for a living, both as an artist as well as an entrepreneur. I look for ways to defamiliarize the ordinary. And so I look for those connections. And many years ago now, I ended up stopped selling all of my artwork. So I don't make any of it available anywhere. I don't sell it online. I don't do necessarily shows or commissioned pieces. I don't, you know, make anyone exit through the gift shop. To see if there's a way that I could kind of disrupt those traditional laws of supply and demand. So discontinue all supply to the marketplace, but continue to raise demand through various different performances that I would do for foundations or for charitable causes. See if there's a way that I could kind of shift that notion of art from being a noun into being an active verb that has the potential to even lessen the suffering of the world. Well, I was doing a show in LA for a charity foundation to end domestic violence. And that night I was doing a painting of Marilyn Monroe. And a young gal named Alicia Moore ended up outbidding everyone else to to get that painting, which wouldn't normally be a big deal, other than the fact that she also doubles as celebrity rock star Pink. In front of the global paparazzi, immediately disrupting the value of every single one of my pieces of art across the board in one social media tweet. So, you know, Anne, I don't know for sure whether you are a fan of the Beatles or John Lennon, but of course that's no longer really the relevant financial question here. The question now is, the sole owner of this particular painting is, are you going to be an art collector or an art broker? So have some fun with that. That is yours to keep following the presentation. Again, one of the best sources there, if you want to, is on eBay. But as I really begs the question, as we look at overcoming and becoming resilient or overcoming obstacles, oftentimes the trail of breadcrumbs trails all the way back to fear. Fear of the unknown. I saw this acronym years ago. I really liked it. You know, what is fear? Most often, false evidence appearing real. Anxiety, worry, concern over those things, which in so many cases, we don't have any business concerning ourselves with, yet we allow those factors to sometimes cripple our creative performance, cripple our future. And I would say that for the future, prosperity of our country, our leadership, our communities, our organizations, is don't allow fear to cripple performance in your community and in your kids. Because really, what is a creative idea worth? What is the ROI on a truly disruptive strategy? A strategy that visibly differentiates from your competition, maybe in ways that they never even dreamed possible. In ways to build trust with your own clients, maybe that hasn't even been invented yet, or they didn't know that they needed. Albert Einstein said, you know, imagination is even more important than knowledge. That's not to discredit knowledge or experience. They're gonna play a critical role in the future operational efficiencies and what it takes to move your product to market, to service your clients, to be that trusted, value-based commodity. But, you know, certainly critical thinking and intelligence, it's not the end goal. It's how do we use that then to form our future? How do we weave in and out of that model? Because truly the paradox of creativity is that structure creates freedom. It's an interesting parallel, but that's where it oftentimes comes. You know, creativity is driven by discipline, and creativity without discipline is like a river without banks. You guys know the way our mind is set up and designed is we've got this analytical, logical, rational problem-solving space in our mind. We also have this kind of intuitive, vulnerable, curious, risk-taking problem spacing in our mind. Yep. Especially in the Western Hemisphere, we as adults exist in that analytical or logical space the vast majority of our waking hours. We're also naturally resistant to venturing out into that uncharted, vulnerable, risk-taking territory. But I also say, you know, it's not our fault. It's not our fault because we were basically programmed to become logical. From the time that we all first entered school, we were taught to take our wonderful, different, multiple creative ideas and then to narrow them down, to come up with just one standardized response. One proper solution that everyone else sitting in straight rows also came up with that just singular answer. And we became naturally resistant. And then that probably increased the challenge even more as we became adults and entered positions of responsibility, as we became parents, as we moved up the professional ladder. And it was almost trained in us to become more operationally efficient. But oftentimes that efficiency or busyness blocks us from opportunities that we hadn't seen before.